And we are live. Welcome to Beastly Thoughts Live, episode 138.
Is it? I didn't look.
Could
the
be.
First episode of 2017.
It's 2017.
As far as you
baby.
Know, it is.
Brand new year, guys.
Hey, happy new year, guys. 2017 happy ringing in that new year. Are you guys excited?
Yes. Oh,
absolutely. This is going to be a great year, man. I just
it
hit
is.
4,000
right?
subscribers on my YouTube channel.
Whoa.
That was like a day ago. I'm already at 4,000, like 55.
Nice.
So it's really happening. People are, I don't know what it is. It must be all the drugs that they're distributing through YouTube videos that
Could
make
be.
People actually like listening to me. It's been really, really good. I'm so happy that
whatever
2016
it takes.
Is behind us. Yeah, whatever. the first dose is free. I'm really looking forward to this year, guys. Last year was a very interesting year in gaming and politics and everything. It was like a mixing pot of madness, 2016. We got tons of great games that happened last year. I think this year is going to be even better. We got two new game yep. consoles looming on the horizon. We got one in March, one holiday 2017. Holiday
right.
this year, January 1st. I'm super excited about what's happening. I'm starting off the year right. I just went out house hunting today. I think I found a new house that I want to get into and settle in and put some roots into the ground and let my babies grow up in it. I'm just really,
it's
really
a, it's
excited.
A house?
It's a house. No more apartments. No more Janene and Tuan living next door. God damn it. Now it's a big, giant house, huge yard. I got my own office slash game room. It's going to be a really beautiful year.
Got
for
an
me.
Office?
Yes, I do.
Oh, man.
Yeah, buddy.
It's so good, bro.
Oh man. I can't wait till you move in. We got to talk. We got to talk about office setups, man, because you know I got a passion.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I trust
you. Sure do, buddy. Yeah.
Okay. The first thing I did when I walked in there and I realized, I was like, wait a minute, this is not a bedroom. What is this? And
it's
built
office.
Right off the side of the house. It's
what
far away from everybody else.
That's weird.
Far away from all the noise. So all the bedrooms are at one end. The other end is just this quaint, beautiful office. Lots of sunlight coming in. Hardwood.
Oh.
The walls are wood panes. It's really sleek and modern. Beautiful. I can't wait to get in there and just
I'm jealous because my office is it's a bedroom basically. I got like the kids' bedroom is the next bedroom over and the master bedroom is like right there. So it's like I at nighttime I gotta be quiet, man. It's hush hush. Gotta be quiet. You gotta talk deep and slowly into the microphone. Get
or
real close.
Just,
close talk voice. Into that microphone. Man, I'm excited for you, Beastly. That's really fucking cool. I hope you everything works out.
It will. You know, I've been working really hard. You know, I make plenty enough to the application to stuff. That's not an issue. So for me, it was just finding something I was comfortable with. Some
yeah.
of the earlier places looked at at the end of the year really didn't suit my taste. And this is in a beautiful neighborhood. It's very, very quiet. Big front yard, huge backyard.
Nice.
And that, to me, it just really, really suited my taste. And Kate can do what she wants to do as far as the living room, dining room. It's just beautiful wallpaper, half wood panes in the dining room, and the other half is this really modern wallpaper. She can do what she wants out there and make the house look Victorian if she wants. But
uh-huh.
my office slash game room is going to have He-Man figures, Thundercats,
uh-huh.
swords, game consoles,
now you're
monitors,
talking.
Green screens, all that shit, and I can't
Ooh.
Wait to do it.
Yeah,
I'm really, really excited.
I just got a little chub.
I got a big one. So it's been 2 weeks
first
without
dick
you
joke
guys.
2017. Let's
first dick there joke was created.
Get it out
by
of the way. Just get it out of the way.
It's
Let's
been
not mess
two
around
solid,
here.
It's been
yeah.
two solid weeks without the Beastly Thought Show. How did you guys, first of all, how did you guys enjoy your holiday? How did you guys celebrate? Is there anything that you guys may have gotten that you would like to talk about and express your gratitude for?
Robbie, talk to me. What'd you get for Christmas?
Yeah,
buddy?
Robbie. And you're still taco truck.
Jeez.
What was the
40s?
Oh, got some new
yeah,
headsets,
buddy.
Huh?
Yep.
Those are nice. They're like all black, aren't they?
No, they're sort of like a military green color. The
oh, really?
Speaker tags are, yeah, and the air cushions. But
go,
so far,
we'll see.
I gotta say, I'm pretty impressed. So.
A little side action there, a little side view. Can we get a little?
Yeah.
Oh
yeah.
Oh yeah. I love the Astros, man. I love the Astros. Are they the TRs? The tournament?
Yeah, A40 tournament ready edition. It comes with the Mixamp M80, and I gotta say, I'm really see why people love Astros. These
mm-hmm.
things are incredibly comfortable, man. Like, you put them on, and it feels like a bunch of pillows are just pushed against your head.
They're very comfortable, right? They are very comfortable. I really like the mix amp because having that volume control right at like on your desk, like right, you know, can be adjusted on the fly. That's really nice, you know? Yeah. Like maybe you got somebody in chat who's screaming a little bit, so you turn on the chat a little bit. Maybe you got you can't quite hear somebody in chat. You turn it up a little bit, you turn down the game sound a little bit. I've really liked that mix amp for a long time. I eventually got away from it and got like a mixing board because of the streaming and stuff. But you know, having a mix amp is huge, and those are very comfortable headphones.
Yeah, and
the TRs have a better microphone on them too, right?
Yeah, that's when I've heard that the microphone quality is better too. Unfortunately, my microphone actually doesn't work. I've been talking to Astro Tech Support about it. I'm gonna have to get a new mic probably. But the rest of the headset is awesome though. Yeah. But unfortunately, my mic just doesn't work.
Return that shit. So. Bring back the store.
And a refund. Like, this shit is not okay.
I'd bring that back to the store. I wouldn't even mess around with tech support. I'd be like, if this thing doesn't work within like a week of buying it,
get the shit out of here.
Yeah, we're just gonna return it and get another one. I've had to deal with Astro Tech Support, and they do not want me to send stuff to them to get it repaired. They will try anything to keep that from happening, I have found.
Good to know.
Like, have you updated your drivers? I'm like, what are you talking about? This piece of plastic is broken. How's the driver gonna help?
Oh shit.
What else did you get, Robbie?
Got a couple games, of course. I got Final Fantasy 15, which I have played an hour or two, and that's a really fun game. I got
you played more than Beastly has.
Yeah, that's true.
The Last Guardian.
More game time.
You said you finished The Last Guardian?
I have not. I've gotten quite a few games over the holiday season. You know, and honestly, it's so many. I can't even remember the names of a lot of them. I mentioned holiday season and games. Robbie just couldn't deal with it. But I've actually been playing a little game called Werewolves Within that I told you about.
Yes, we got to play that together, man. I've got it downloaded.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because I sent you a text, and I asked you. I said, "Hey, you need to get this game. It is a ton of fun." You know what? I'm going to create this whole new segment on my YouTube channel called Tales. I think I'm trying to remember the name. Is it Yharnam or Yharnam? The little village in this game.
Yeah.
You meet some very interesting people. When you play,
right? Because it's live chat, right?
It's basically a live chat with up to 8 people that you don't know, and when you meet them, every time that you speak, your character actually emotes. They move their hands around, and if you raise your voice, they throw their hands up. So it really seems like they're having a real conversation. If you look over at someone, you can point to them, and you can like tell them that you're really getting sick up. Just so many different types of things you can do, and dealing with these people and watch some people really get into character. And to me, that is it's better than the actual game. The game is a lot of fun because basically the whole premise of the game is to see if you can lie your way out of getting people, you know, if you're a werewolf or if you're a turncloak, getting people to not vote for you or vote for you, depending on lies and how well you're able to manipulate the table. As you play the game, you learn what other roles are. There are things like astronomers. And certain characters have abilities, like the astronomer. If you are lucky enough to become the astronomer, you look up at the sky and you see a moon appear in front of you. And as the moon like goes to a full moon, once you look at your journal, you can see a note. It'll say that this person is either one or two different things. So you can let the people in the village know maybe this person's a werewolf. He's either a werewolf or a deviant. And people look at that person and it helps you vote against him. But like say, for instance, you're a werewolf and you know that the role of astronomer, you know, allows you this ability. You can lie to the table and say you're an astronomer. You can look up. People will see your character look up. Then you can just basically, you know who the werewolf is. You can look across the table and see who the bad guys are. And you can just start to vote off another person and say, this person's lying. I'm an astronomer.
So you're just there to be the douchebag.
You can. And so a lot of these roles, they work in tandem that way. And depending on what your job is, you can really work with your team if you're a good guy and work against the other team if you're a bad guy. And it's a lot of fun. But like I said, some of the things I've seen in this game that have really, really intrigued me are people who get into character. You see these people come and, you know, there's this one guy who looks like Jafar from Aladdin. And these people will change their voice and talk about what they were doing in the village and how much they hate sitting at this table and how badly they want to eat one of the pumpkins that are sitting off to the side. It just really feels like you're in this crazy world with these crazy people. It's a ton of fun. It really is. It's one of my favorite PlayStation VR games now. It's even gotten to the point now where I'm on Google and looking, you know, into the forums to figure out some of the best strategies for different roles so that you can actually manipulate other players. It's a lot of fun. Found out today that it's actually, it was created as a real board game. It was a real card. Yeah, it was a real card game with different classes, and they changed it for Oculus Rift and HTC Vive and PlayStation VR, added new classes to make it more fun. But it's a great game. I really, really enjoy it.
All right, I got some questions for you, because I'm really intrigued by this game. First of all, it's cross-platform, right? So if you're playing with people who have Vive, PlayStation VR, and Oculus, right? It doesn't matter what you have. You can play with everybody.
Yep, everybody
can play together. That's great. So hopefully that means there's a bigger community. Second is, what does VR bring to it?
VR for me, hold on, Robbie. VR for me, what it does, it just adds a whole new layer to the experience. Like if you look over and you see someone sitting next to you, and you can tell they're kind of looking at you. Like as you turn your head in VR, your character's eyes will actually articulate and look at that person. So you can look and see a guy kind of looking at you at the corner of his eye, and he'll lean over towards you. And if you lean over towards him and you start to whisper, you can hear him, but nobody else can.
Get out of here.
Yeah, yeah. So people can see you. Like, this is what happens to the people who aren't whispering. If people start whispering, you hear, and you look around to see who's whispering. Because it could be a werewolf talking to a turncloak, and they work together, or a werewolf talking to a deviant. And so the guy could say, hey, look, I'm a werewolf. You are this, and we need to try to get this person out. And then they could come back and say, hey, no, I'm not a werewolf. I was just at... And werewolves also have the ability, like if you get up on someone, you're a werewolf, and you pretend to whisper to them, you can smell them and you identify their real role. So you can tell the other werewolves what this person is. So it's
that's
just
awesome.
So many that different aspects cool. to VR that have been added into this game. And it's a ton of fun. I'm really, really happy I bought it. I had it now for 2 weeks. It's a great game. And it's one of those games, Brian, that once you start to actually learn the roles, learn the rules, learn how to manipulate the people at the table. And you, hey, look, man, I swear you can stand up. If you stand up, like if everybody's voted, you know, before the actual hourglass of time runs out in this game, you see it in the middle of the table. There's an hourglass there. And, it, you know, by the time the sand goes through, then it's time to vote off who you believe is either the werewolf. And if you see, you know, all these little icons above your head, that means everyone is expressed that there's something off about you. It's suspicion. Like you can place suspicion on someone if you're a villager or you know, a good person. And if a person's acting shady, maybe not talking, or maybe, you know, you can kind of tell they're lying, you can select them and place suspicion on them. It'll be a big ball above their head. And as more and more people suspect this person, there'll be three or four balls. And if you're really not a villain and you see all these balls above your head, you can stand up and appeal to these people. And if you do that, your character will actually do it. Like you can actually stand up in real life, your character will do it, or you can hold the R2 button and you can stand up. You can program all these emotes. There's like 30 different emotes. Like you can do this, you can point, you can, you know, yell, you know,
fan. Can you use the move controllers to do all this stuff?
You just no. You push.
Use the controller.
I believe it's R2. Yeah,
I don't know if you guys have ever noticed, but when I talk, I use my hands a lot.
Yeah, actually, it's R2 up, down, left, or right on the D-pad. So you can R2 and L2. So there's like six different emotes you can choose depending on the situation, and you can get up and you can appeal to the people and say, "Look, this motherfucker right here is full of shit," and everybody will look at this person.
I love things
and
like
he'll
that.
Look at you. The funniest thing, I haven't uploaded any video of this yet. The very first game that I played, the very first one, I have it on video. I came in there to this group of people. I was observing first from a distance, maybe like a foot or two behind the table. They couldn't hear me, but I could hear the entire conversation. The game was over. Then I was finally invited to the game. And I sat down and I said, hey, guys, I just want to say this is my very first game. And some guy looked at me and said, Beasley, why are you lying? I can verify. I played 20 games with his ass.
Why are you lying?
I said, what? He said, I played 20. And then another guy came and said, yeah, I just checked his IP. He's lying. Is that? I was like, this is fucking awesome. A bunch of assholes playing this game.
All right, I got one more question for you. Yeah. Well, when we do play this together, how does the matchmaking work? Can we make sure that we're on the same team? Like, how does that work?
I haven't had, and there's no one I know personally.
All right, so we gotta experiment with it to figure out. Yeah, we can try.
But the thing is, you don't really want to be on the same team because, I mean, you can, but it's more fun if you pretend like you are, and I find out that you're lying your ass off. It's a game about lying, and it's a game about being forthright in your thoughts that you are right, and you're not a werewolf, and you're not here to kill people, and you're here to protect the village. And these fucking guys are lying their ass off, and it's just so much more fun. Like, if you and I are on the same team, and you are a werewolf, and you're pretending not to be, and I actually believe your ass, and at the end of the game, it reveals that you're a werewolf, and I'm like, oh, you lying fuck. That's what makes the game so
lying bastard.
It's a lot
I can't
of fun.
Wait to do this, man. I'm going to – hey, I've got to download it. I bought it, and I downloaded it, so it's just a matter of, like, jumping in and playing it. I feel like this would be really fun to stream, too, because having
that
the
is.
Like
it's a lot of fun.
Having the chat, like, just like watch you, like, because they're seeing your screen, right? So they know if
they
you're
know
lying
you
or not.
Are.
And having them fucking know what you're up to. The only problem is with the VR headset. The only problem with streaming with a VR headset is that you can't really read chat while you're doing it.
No.
So there, I'd have to figure. Maybe I just cut a hole in the so I can just peek through.
This is my chat. Thing, right?
Or get like a HoloLens to wear under my VR glasses so I can read chat. Like a Google Glass.
This is what I wanted to do, right? I wanted to figure out a way that I could pull up, you know, every single strategy for, like, if you're a werewolf, if you're a turncloak, if you're a deviant. I think I may be getting the deviant and turncloak roles confused, but there's one role. I think it might be the deviant. Your job is to actually get voted. You want people to believe that you're the werewolf.
Yeah.
So you do everything possible. So, I mean, you know, for instance, that you're not a werewolf, but you'll say something just very out there, and people will look at you and they'll place suspicion. And then you just act real shady, and they'll say, that's a fucking werewolf. And then if you get picked as the deviant, you win and the werewolves win. So it's just so many different aspects to the game. It's very, very fun. I can't wait to play it with you.
What's the name of the game again?
Werewolves Within on PlayStation VR, Oculus Rift, and the HTC Vive. It's a lot of fun, man.
I'm excited for this game.
This is the only game that's gotten me thinking of divorcing my wife. She won't even put the headset on.
Careful what you say on stream live.
I said, hey, look. Oh, she can watch this shit.
She knows
I'm gangster with this shit. You know I'm gangster, Kate. I said, put on the damn VR headset. She said, no. I said, why? She said, shut up. I said, okay. But hey, I'm married. I know when to stop.
Gangster.
Yeah. Dog life. But she's not really into VR now. I think that some of these games, like Here They Lie, these games that got her really motion sick.
Yeah.
Especially with her being 8 months pregnant.
Here They Lie is terrible. It's awful. God,
it really is. It makes you feel like your heart's about to come out of your throat.
Yeah.
It's a really bad situation. But this game, Briar, you get none of that. This is. Of course, you're not moving around. You just lean forward, and you can lean over.
Were
you
like sitting around like a card table kind of thing?
It's different locales. It's like a big castle in the background. Sometimes you play at the castle, like on the back patio, and there's ice sculptures around of werewolves and shit. You'll be out in the village. It's like three or four different locations, but you don't get any feeling of that vertigo sensation. It feels really, really good when you look around and you talk to people. It's just a great game. It's a really fun experience, and I can't wait to play it with you. Just let me know when you're ready. And so for anybody out there who's playing PlayStation VR who played Werewolves Within, please let us know what you think about it in the comments below. I really want to find a way to find out all the roles and find out the best strategies. Like if you're actually on the opposing team, the liars of maybe things that you can say, like if you're a werewolf and you want to pick. Because what happens is for every match, if you go to your journal, it shows everybody the available different roles that may be in this game. It'll show like 10 different roles and there'll be 8 people. And so not all of them will be in the game, but you know that if it's not on this sheet of paper, they're definitely not there. So say, for instance, use astronomer again. If a person who's a werewolf and they say, I'm an astronomer, you look in the book and you can see there's no astronomer there. That raises a lot of suspicion about the character. So you got to be really, really smart and figure out exactly what you can say, what you can do, and, you know, manipulate the team. But it's a lot of fun. Another game that I've been playing that I bought, another one of these holiday deals, is Final Fantasy XIV, A Realm Reborn, which is, it's Final Fantasy, guys. How you like that? It's the MMO Final Fantasy.
It's one of the good ones, apparently, so, yeah.
It's a lot of fun if you're really into MMOs.
Nope, Ryer's tuning out. I self-pulled the iPad. I'm like, yeah. He's like, I don't even care.
I'll make this quick because I know there are a lot of people out there who play MMOs. I used to really play a lot of MMOs on my PC. Believe it or not, one of my favorite PC games years ago, which is not a fan favorite, is called Silk Road Online. I played that game for years. Oh, really? I still have.
That's where you get the drugs, right?
Well, that's the real Silk Road, Briar, not the game. But it's good, very enlightening to see that you do know about the Silk Road. In Final Fantasy XIV, A Realm Reborn, you can pick, I believe, up to 6 different classes. Of course, there are heavy RPG elements into the game, allocating skill points towards your mana, your health points, intelligence, things like that to really alter the way that your character plays. Of course, you can choose tank classes, healer classes, damage dealing wizards and white elves and dark elves and all these different things. And we've only been playing it for a few hours. Kate actually wants to play as soon as I get done with Beastly Thoughts because we've been having a lot of fun with it. And this is one of those games on PlayStation where you actually have to physically buy 2 different copies of the game. So I couldn't use what I normally do. Normally I'll buy one game on my PlayStation 4 and it's immediately downloadable on hers. But this game doesn't work that way. So you have to buy... Lame Square.
Because you both want to be playing at the same time, or?
I don't know. It's like each individual download is tethered to your PSN somehow.
Really?
So it's not like you can just log in. So I had to buy 2 of them. But we've been having quite a bit of fun. Does it do anything new and spectacular that other MMOs haven't? No. It's pretty straightforward at this point. We're both only like level 12. We just started getting good weapons and buying them. We're still trying to figure out where to go. The game is huge. This gigantic open world. A majority of the game is not spoken dialogue. It's a lot of reading. It's like if you want to play a game that's a game centered around Encyclopedia Britannica, then this is the game. So for the last maybe 30 or 40 missions, we've just kept hitting that X button to get through all that fucking reading so we can go do something else. But for the most part, we've been having a lot of fun leveling up our characters. And we're probably going to see a good portion of this game through. Of course, it's not a free-to-play game. It is a premium to play it monthly, $13 per month. And we'll see after our first 30 days how much more we want to play. But as of right now, we've been having a pretty good amount of fun playing it. It looks like it's going to be a good year.
Good. Good.
It's going to be a good year.
Did you get any like physical stuff, Beastly, for Christmas that you want to tell us about?
I got a lot of clothes. My wife bought me a lot of clothes. I mean, my closet is filled.
So many clothes. I'm happy about it, though. I can't complain.
I mean, it's nothing wrong with getting things. Kate bought me a lot of shirts from Japan. She bought me a lot of stuff from Japan, and I was more shocked that Japanese people had shit that fit someone my size. But she bought me some Last Guardian shirts, lots of PlayStation stuff, a PlayStation hat. But the thing that I got, which I was really, really happy about. When I was a youngster, I liked getting physical games and stuff. Like my kids, they got iPhone 7s and Beats headphones and you know PlayStation cards and everything. I got money from a lot of people. Hey. And
I love money.
Well, doesn't matter who gives it to me. I'm just like you, Briar. So we got money from family. You know, Kate's her dad, uncles. My family's poor. They didn't give me shit. They came over and actually ate on Christmas, bastards. But her family was sending cards and money from everywhere. I mean, I was literally running to the mailbox every 20 minutes. I was like, is there more in there? This is amazing. But it's been a really good Christmas for our family. Having a lot of fun. I never got Telltale's The Walking Dead Michonne. I picked that up to see what it was like. I also got Unravel because it was on sale.
Unravel's nice. I like that game.
Yeah. That looks so fun. Yeah.
I saw Nova playing it. And of course, my boys, they got a couple $100 for Visa card so they could feel like adults. Sure. They're doing actually really good. They've only bought a handful of games so far.
Did you get a chance to play Unravel at all?
No, I saw it today. It looks really good. It looks good.
Yeah, it's cool. It's a nice, quick experience. It's nice. It's just a nice game.
Yeah, it's a nice game.
It's a nice game.
Well, you know, I went out today.
Describe a game. It's nice.
I went out looking at houses and stuff. So, you know, it was kind of in and out of the house and the girls were playing it. But, man, I'm looking forward to this year. It's going to be a great year for gaming for me. Last year.
It is. It's going to be a good year for games.
I tallied up all the games that I bought last year and it was 43 games. Actual games.
Whoa,
that I paid.
Wow.
It's really, really stupendous the amount of games that I went
just
through.
Doing the math. I don't even want to say
how much money that was. Yeah.
I'm trying to see where my file list because I saved it because I was actually going to make a video about this to let people know exactly how many games I got. And oh, here it is, my games list. I'll go through it real quick. These are games I actually bought, not PlayStation Plus stuff. I got Gone Home Console Edition, The Banner Saga on PlayStation 4, Life is Strange Limited Edition. I bought that. Ooh. Dying Light, The Following.
We don't need to hear all 43.
Oh, God, Briar. We're just racing. Street Fighter V, Far Cry Primal, Just Cause 3, Tom Clancy's The Division, Quantum Break, Dark Souls 3, Uncharted 4, Dishonored 2, Doom, PS4, Homefront Revolution, PS4, Overwatch, PS4.
You bought that? Oh, I feel bad. Was it bad?
I didn't play it. It's still in there.
Really?
It's actually a physical disc, too. Oh, God. You know what? Homefront Revolution might not have been a great game, but... Somehow, or even a good one. Yeah,
I've heard it's just not very good at all. Like it's.
I've seen some great videos come out of it.
What do you guys think is worse, Homefront or No Man's Sky? I think we're all guilty here.
Homefront. No Man's Sky is not a bad game. It's not a good one, but it's not a bad one.
Okay, guys, I get it. Okay, all right. So continuing on, I got Overwatch, The Last Guardian, Rise of the Tomb Raider on PC, Naruto Shippuden Ultimate Ninja Storm 4, Salt and Sanctuary, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles PS4, I played the first stage of that, The Witcher 3 Blood and Wine, Guilty Gear Zerd, come back Robbie, Odin Sphere, Lethal Seer, 7 Days to Die, Resident Evil 4, I did buy the PlayStation VR, Arkham VR this year, now. PlayStation VR Worlds, The Brookhaven Experiment, Until Dawn, Rush of Blood, Werewolves Within. Are you guys still with me?
Infinite
Warfare, Final Fantasy, Heaven Sword, Skyrim Remastered, Mega Man Legacy, Resident Evil 5, Oregon Trail, Grand Kingdom PS4, Shantae Risky's Revenge, Dark Souls 3, and Jackbox Party Pack 1 and 2. And fuck you guys for not listening.
Huh? I was listening. Jackbox Party Pack 1 and 2. Hey.
Jackbox, really?
Yeah, I heard that.
God damn it. It's going to be a good
game. I mean, I heard some of them.
It's going to be a great year.
That was so good.
I'm so happy to be here with you guys. Yeah. I missed you guys. I honestly did.
Beasley, you mentioned The Division in there.
Yeah.
Okay. I want you to jump back into The Division with me. I've been playing Survival. Cool. The new game mode that came out for The Division.
What about me?
It is fantastic.
Really?
It is. Robbie's like, what about me? Well, you didn't mention The Division. That's why the comment is aimed at Beasley for a successful transition, which you have now ruined.
All right, Robbie.
Sorry.
Did you learn anything last year?
Just quit the show. I'm sorry, okay? I'll leave.
All right, so I've been playing a ton of The Division over the last, I think, about a week, right? I really like survival mode. It is this bite-sized like chunk. What?
Is it like a horde mode?
It's like a survival mode. It's what you do is you spawn in, and you've got nothing, right? You've got a pistol, and that's it. You spawn in, and you basically got to go and find stuff. The goal is to extract, right? Your goal is to finally extract. Go into the dark zone and extract. You start off by just kind of wandering around and trying to collect stuff. You got a lot of stuff to worry about. You got to worry about your hunger, so you got to make sure you're fed. You got to worry about your thirst. You got to make sure that you have water. And you've got this kind of countdown clock going. I think it starts at 45 minutes or an hour of your viral status. Basically, you got sepsis, and you're dying. You're very sick, and you're dying, so you got to find meds to keep yourself going. So you've got all these different things to worry about. Plus you start off with really shitty loot and you've got to survive basically by finding loot, gearing up, getting into the dark zone, finding the antivirals, and then getting to an extraction point and getting out of there. It is basically, I swear to God, the most fun I've ever had with The Division by a long shot. This is the game mode that should have shipped with this game. It is so fun. It takes
how
an hour. What's that?
How new is this mode?
It just came out. It came out, I think it came out last month for PC and Xbox One, and it came out this month for PS4.
Yeah. Brand new PS4.
It takes an hour. You know, it might be less if you die right away, because when you start off, you've got nothing, right? You're very weak. You can survive about 2 minutes out in the weather before you've got to find a heat source.
Really? They've added all this?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. You'll die if you don't get
You'll die. In fact, I either die in the first 5 minutes or I die after an hour and a half or 2 hours. Like, that's there's no in-between for me. It's really weird like that. Because I think I'm a little impatient. That's at the beginning, so, I just like run for it.
What is the overall goal of survival? Is it to survive as long as you can, or is it to extract
the goal
something?
Is to get out. The goal is to extract. There's like a little story bit, a little cutscene that kind of sets it up for you. But you're going in to get these antivirals and get out. Your helicopter crashes. You don't have any gear. You're sick. You're hazmat suit has been all cut open. You don't have any cold weather gear, so you got to find all that. You got to find weapons. You got to find armor. You got to find food. You got to find water, and you got to find medicines just so you don't die.
Yeah.
And while you're doing that, you got to stay inside or near fire so you don't freeze to death.
Okay, my question for you is, when you start this mode, is this a whole new area that was created specifically for this mode?
No,
it's the map that we're used to.
It's the map that we're used to, but they changed a couple of things. They changed where the loot is, obviously, and they changed where the bad guys are spawning. But they also changed the weather, so it's like this really heavy duty snowstorm, which plays into the gameplay because you'll be running down a street and you can't really see much of anything.
Wow.
So you've got to get up close to things to find out if there's loot there. You're constantly looking for barrels to warm your hands by, to warm up, or you're looking for hideouts to loot, you know, find some loot, you know, like those apartment buildings, remember those that you'd go into and, you know, stuff like that, storefronts, stuff like that, so you could find electronics and parts to make weapons and stuff like that.
Now, I heard you mention the Dark Zone. How does that play into this particular mode?
The Dark Zone is a difficulty spike. So you got to make sure you gear up before you go to the Dark Zone.
That's how you get extracted.
You can only get extracted from inside the Dark Zone, and the extraction mechanic works like it did for the regular game.
Wow.
The difference is when you pop that, you have to, first of all, you have to make your own flare gun. So you have to find the parts to make your flare gun. So you have this mission objective that's in the Dark Zone. It's finding this this antiviral. When you find that, then your mission is to go to an extraction point and get extracted. To do that, you have to build your own flare gun, go to the extraction point, pop the flare gun, and then a hunter comes for you. And the hunter is like a badass enemy that is just, its sole goal is just to kill you. And it's pretty fun, man.
The hunter spawns inside the Dark Zone and tracks you and chases you?
Yeah.
Now, in the Dark Zone, are the traditional PvP people in there as well? Or
you have an option to play PvP or PvE. If you play PvE, there's no obviously PvE. There's no player versus player at all. If you do choose to play PvP, then you can shoot people. You can shoot other players.
Now, question. I didn't hear much. I heard you say you want me to play, and I'll definitely do that. And my wife is down, too, because she had a lot of fun playing The Division. When you spawn in, are you able to join a party immediately? Can you meet people in the world and join up? And wow.
Yeah, if you want.
I wish this was in it initially.
I don't know, man. It's the best part of The Division by a long shot. It is fun. You get immediate like enjoyment out of gearing up your character, and you've got this kind of constant level of stress because you're managing, like, do I have
resources?
Do I have medicine? Do I have water? Do I have food? Am I freezing to death? Do I have any weapons that can like kill anything? Because you start off with a pistol that, you know, you can kill a red health bar guy, but three of them could mess you up pretty good, and a purple guy will rock your world.
Wow. So when it comes to the loot that you get in this mode, are you able? Does it transfer to the regular game, or?
Because I'm sorry, I understand
when it came to The Division as its standalone version, part of the game that made part of an aspect of the game that made it really enjoyable was all the loot that you found and how you're able to store it and keep it. Now in this mode, every time you play it, you start completely fresh.
You start fresh, and you don't keep the stuff that you find. However, you get rewards. If you're in the Dark Zone, you can find high-end packages that'll, you know, like basically decrypt into armor or weapons. And then even if you don't make it, even if you don't finish, you get packages like that just for playing. So you just playing survival it will help you get good gear for your main character too.
Sweet.
Which I don't care about because I don't like the Division. Like, I don't like that game. But I love the survival. I love survival mode.
Yeah. Well, let me just say this. We have a litany of games that you and I are supposed to play together. Now we got some VR stuff. Definitely the Division. I know how tough it's been for you and I to get together and play, but just let me know when you want to, and I'm down 100%.
I'm down too. I think I'm going to re-download the Division. I think I'm going to buy it. Yeah, because this sounds really good. Like, this sounds exactly like what I wanted from the Division from day one. This sounds awesome.
This
really
DLC, exciting. What is the cost of this DLC, or was it just freely included?
I don't remember. I don't know, because I bought the Gold Edition back in March when it came out, March 2016, because I was so excited about the game.
Yeah.
And then, so I don't really know what the DLCs cost.
I think it's $15, I believe, for each one.
Even if you don't like The Division, it's worth checking out.
I like The Division. I did like it.
I just wish there was more. And there were things like the Dark Souls leveling and playing with other people that kind of turned me off.
That,
like,
turned us off too. Kate and I, we went through the entire Division together, had a great time playing the actual campaign and finding items and, you know, traveling through this fast city. But when it came to the Dark Zone, it turned her off. And I was like, well, shit, now I'm losing my teammate. I guess we'll go play something else. So it sounds really interesting to me that they've brought, you know, something else, you know, to really bring back maybe some of the old hardcore fans who didn't have much to do in the game to start with. And if you say that this is the best aspect of the game, then I definitely believe it.
Standalone, to me, it's worth the purchase of the game. That's how good it is.
Wow.
You know, it's like those survival games, you know, that are always in early access, but it's a finished product and it's good.
Actually a completed game. Gotcha.
Right. Yeah. That's what it feels like.
I got a quick question for you. I'm sorry, Robbie. I wish I could ask you about it, but as time goes on, Robbie, and you get your VR, then we're going to have this discussion. There's some new applications available on PlayStation VR. Have you had the opportunity to check them out, Briar?
I downloaded Fruit Ninja and is it called Prepare to Die?
I believe so.
I Want You to Die, something like that. And Fruit Ninja is stupid and fun.
Well, it's fun though. Okay.
It is fun. It's fun basically your move controllers are two swords and then you play Fruit Ninja.
Then you're just going like this.
Yeah.
No, I mean, there's actually some really deep gameplay in it. You can catch the fruit with one sword and slice it in half with the other. So I think they did a really good job on that. I haven't had a chance to try.
It's a dumb, fun game.
Yeah.
I Expect You to Die. I think it's called I Expect You to Die.
Yeah.
I haven't played it yet. I downloaded it, but I haven't played it yet.
Well, there's some new applications and even a new YouTube application that's on the horizon for PlayStation VR that'll be out really soon. But there's a new YouTube application coming to PlayStation 4 that allows the playback of 360 videos.
Ooh.
Yeah. I actually did a video about it last week. And basically, the 360 videos you can watch on your phones or tablets, or even on your desktop computer, you'll be able to access them through PlayStation VR. And I think that's really, really awesome. But there's an application that's available now. It's totally free. It's called Jaunt, J-A-U-N-T, which is a PlayStation VR video playback application. And it has over 150 short films on it now, including a short film series. It's like a 5-episode series, Briar. And each episode's like 3 minutes long. I don't know. You know, a lot of people can't deal with the VR thing for too long. But I've given this thing I've tried it out and I've played with it extensively and watched some of the videos on the Jaunt application. And I just didn't know if you had tried it. And I wanted to kind of share my thoughts on it. If people out there are on PlayStation VR, if you do have PlayStation VR and you like watching movies, then the Jaunt application might be right up your alley.
I downloaded this. I haven't tried it yet. I'm interested in this.
There's a lot of free stuff. Don't get too super excited about it. The video playback quality leaves tons to be desired. It is very, very low resolution. And when I say low,
but it's 3D.
It's like totally it's 3D. It's
360 surround.
Yeah, 100%. Everywhere you look, you can see every angle of the situation. And sometimes, like, there's this film the series I was watching where there was an invisible entity coming to abduct this girl, and everyone in the hospital was trying to stop this thing. You could see kind of like the Predator style coming down the hallway. You're like, oh, what the hell is that? Because you could see the people talking, but you also see the hall. And then the camera angle would change, and you'd see this thing decimate people. It's really entertaining to see it. And of course, with PlayStation VR, you know, it doesn't have the hardware capabilities to have really outstanding resolution when you're watching these type of videos. But I feel like with the Jaunt application, there is more that can be done. It's kind of a new thing. PlayStation VR, it's kind of new at VR. The Jaunt application already exists on Oculus Rift and HTC Vive. And from the reviews I've seen on the application for those other VR headsets, it does look markedly better than on PlayStation VR. But I think that the technology and the direction they're going with applications like this for PlayStation VR are really good for the casual VR owners, the people who don't want to sit and play through Valkyrie or play through an entire game, but maybe watch 5 or 10 minutes worth of this VR type of 360 video series. And I really, really like what they're doing with it. So when you get a chance to check it out, let me know. So I can get your thoughts. Don't get super hyped and excited right now. I think that the future is really bright, especially once we see new iterations of PlayStation's VR technology. But right now, you know, that'll ground floor type of stuff, I think it's really exciting. I can say, you know, for me at least, beyond a doubt, the virtual reality and augmented reality is definitely the future of home-based entertainment. You know, being in
I don't know if I'll ever be sitting around watching TV or movies. Yeah. Like I don't know.
It has to be something that's easier to digest than sticking on this headset and people watching you know experience something. I think maybe in 5 or 10 years, once the technology reaches this particular point where it's much easier for people to interact with it and experience it without, you know, kind of isolating yourself and isolating the experience. Maybe once technology gets to the point where you can put on maybe some sunglasses and in maybe 3 or 4 pairs in a living room environment and everybody's there experiencing it in their own particular way, I think it'll take off. But I really like what they're doing, especially the fact that these are very short films, and it does make you feel like you're experiencing it in a way that you can't experience it on a television. You know, I actually went through a situation in a short zombie film, it's only like 3 minutes long, where I was infected and my girlfriend was trying to get me out, and you know, I'm looking around watching these zombies attack
me. Quiet down, Kate's gonna hear.
Oh, wow. Oh, shit. And so I was, you experience it. You feel like you're actually going through it. And then, you know, the camera kind of fades in and out. And you're like, wow, this must be what it's really like to feel, to lose yourself to an infection like this. And
to the music.
You know, yeah, it's exactly where I was going with it. But to lose yourself to this infection and kind of have these flashbacks of you and her when, you know, when things were totally fine, and then come back to the present and see all this shit happening around you and explosions. And I think it's a really a bright future for virtual reality. And if you guys have PlayStation VR, the application is called Jaunt. It's totally free. And I did do a video on it with some really funny clips of people who were not acting when they were supposed to be acting.
Yep.
There's this one girl who stood there for the entire film, and she didn't move at all. Everyone else was moving. There were zombies. And this chick basically posted up in the corner behind you and waited until the car pulled up, till the people exited the car, and she moved when she got shot and laid down. And I was really, really pissed off because everybody else at least tried. This chick just stood there.
Yeah, yeah.
And did you see the video?
Cool for school, huh?
She just stood there. You know, her hair was blowing in the wind. And I was like, what the hell is this chick doing? And she just stood there and waited for the people to get out and start shooting the zombies. Then she just went down. I was like, wow, they should have fired this chick before they put her on camera.
But Gary Diaz in chat also says, if you rub Vaseline in your eyes, you can experience the same thing in real life, too.
Absolutely. Yes. Absolutely. Absolutely. But, you know, Robbie's still young. He uses Vaseline for other things. It's not going on his eyes. So, Brian, what have you been...
It's 2017. I won't get into detail on that.
All right. What have you been playing, Breyer? I know that you mentioned some Division.
Yeah, the Division I'm still trucking along on. I'm doing the Dawning event in Destiny. Kind of finished with it, though. Looking forward to whatever's next for Destiny. Major content drought, frankly, is staring us right in the face in the Destiny world. Everybody's really looking forward to Destiny 2. Not 100% convinced it's going to come out in 2017.
What?
It could get pushed. You're right.
No, are you serious? It could get pushed.
No. Yeah.
I don't know. Like, I'm not 100% convinced. Like, AAA game like that, like, you'd think that we'd at least know something about it.
God, maybe not necessarily. I think
maybe not necessarily. You're right. Not necessarily.
Well, if be that as it may, something needs to be announced soon. I'm talking within the next 90 days. They need to either talk about Destiny 2 or talk about a new expansion to keep, because Destiny did something that other games haven't done. It kept people around for this long.
Yeah.
Nobody is playing games that came out the same month as Destiny right now. There's not any avid fans.
Maybe MMOs, like stuff like that, is probably the only thing. I'm looking forward to like hearing what the next thing about Destiny is going to be. I've been playing The Witcher still. I have dropped off a little bit because of The Division has really kind of caught me by the gonads. But I'm still loving that game. The story in that game is fantastic. I really enjoy that game.
Yeah.
And then I've been messing around with some VR stuff. I downloaded Fruit Ninja. I downloaded the Resident Evil demo, the newer version of it.
Oh, that looks good, doesn't it?
No.
Oh, it doesn't?
I mean,
it looks good.
If you're into that. If you're into that. That game comes out next month. And
this month. It's January.
Yeah, you're right. This month. It comes out this month. And I'm interested because it looks like a cool ass VR game.
Oh, it looks fucking awesome, man.
But it also looks terrifying. And I don't know if I want to have like a heart attack while I'm playing it.
That's a real concern, you know. You got to take that into account. So.
All you very need to true. Do, Briar, is make sure that you name, you know, a very dependable beneficiary and live stream it, and everybody wins.
Yeah.
I'll say this about the new Resident Evil VR demo. This is the best looking PlayStation VR game. When you put it on, it looks crisp. It looks clean. It doesn't look like anything else on PlayStation VR. Somehow they're able to extract every ounce of technical heart and soul that the developers put into this game to make it look really, really crisp and clean in VR. I like the fact that you actually move around with the controller. And, of course, you can't turn super fast in the game and look behind you. They've, you know, included the ability, kind of like with the game Here They Lie, which makes you die when you play it, to actually turn, you know, hit the analog stick and it'll jump a few frames so you can actually turn around behind you. I can't wait to play this game. I'm a huge Resident Evil fan. There's lots and lots of spoilers about this game out right now. The game, basically all the details of the game have been leaked, so I've been staying away from that.
Yeah, careful but on those spoilers.
From what I can't spoil it. I'm not listening to that shit. But from what I understand, Capcom has completely rewritten and gone in a totally new direction from what we're used to as far as zombies. This is more of a psychological horror slash family.
The demo kind of makes it look like it's like almost like a The Hills Have Eyes kind
of
thing.
Yeah, it's one of those type of groups of people that seem like, you know, atomic fallout turned them into these people who don't really feel pain and that are just really, really perverted. I can't wait to play it. I'm super excited about it. I don't know what it is, and I don't know if your family's the same way, Briar. I don't know if your wife has even tried VR, but I wish more people were excited about it. I don't know if bad experiences will turn people away wholeheartedly. I think that, you know, initially my wife was super amped for VR, just like I was. She had a few bad experiences, and like she hasn't put it on since. And I'm not kidding. Kate hasn't put on the VR headset in, I would say, 6 weeks. She hasn't put it on.
Oh, wow.
So I'm like, I talk to her every night. I'm like a broken record. I say, are you going to play Werewolf Within? She goes, no, not tonight. I say, that's what you've been saying for the last 2 fucking weeks. But, more and more people get to play these games, the games that won't give you these bad experiences, because it's a new experience. It's a very entertaining experience. And I think that if you have a good experience, it can keep you on board for longer.
Did she play Here They Lie?
Yeah, she did. She sure did. That was one of the first games she played. She took it off like after 2 minutes. It's really, really bad. It's some games, the developers haven't mastered the movement in virtual reality space.
Or even apparently attempted to try.
Yeah, I don't know how they even tried.
Here they puke all over the place with that game.
Certain games really, really make you feel bad. Other games you don't have any issues with. You know, and maybe VR isn't for every type of game. You know, I played Drive Club. Didn't have any trouble with that game. It worked really well for me. Yeah. But certain games, it's like if you take three steps in the game world, you're hurling all over the place, and you got to figure this stuff out, developers. Sony, you know, maybe you need to mandate certain aspects of VR direction when it comes to producing these games so people don't have these bad experiences. Because if there's a house full of kids and mom and dad have a bad experience on PlayStation VR, maybe at a demo stop, they're not going to buy it for their kids because they're going to think that every game is going to screw their kids over.
Well, here's the thing, and I can relate to Kate a little bit here because I play VR, but what I'll basically do is I'll go to the PlayStation store. I'll be like, all right, what's new in VR? I'll download, you know, three or four games. You know, even small games for VR cost $20 to $30, which I think is exorbitant.
Ridiculous.
And the free stuff is, you know, very quick. You know, it's like these little bite-sized chunks are very small. So seeing something like Resident Evil, where it's like a big AAA game, that's a huge step. It's a huge step for VR, and I'm hoping this game is really good. Like because I would like to see VR move forward, right? I would like to see developers start developing games, real games, specifically for VR.
Could Resident Evil 7 be that first real true
VR game? So. You know, it might be a stepping stone. Yeah. It's not. What VR doesn't have is that application. It doesn't have that game that says, "This is why I need VR." Fruit Ninja.
This is why this exists. Yeah.
Yeah. Fruit Ninja. All these like little sampler experiences just don't do that. There's, for those of you who've tried it, like, you know, me and Beastly and Gary's in chat. We've tried this stuff, and there's real potential there. You can see that potential. You know, definitely. Even Fruit Ninja.
Oh,
when I'm
no doubt.
Slicing around with these swords, man, I'm thinking to myself, this is dumb. But if I was actually fighting like a samurai, like this was one-to-one controls, this is the Wii dream, right? Is like, this is what we were hoping we were going to get. And imagine if it becomes like a fighting game where me and Beastly face off. I get to be like a Viking with an axe and a shield, and Beastly gets to be a samurai with like a, you know, this long samurai sword. And basically, like, imagine that, you know, like, it'd be so cool.
That would be incredible. And it's like, it seems like such a no-brainer to create something like that, where there's an arena, there's eight people sitting on the side watching, you know, in the front row, there are people in line waiting to fight the winner. And it seems like such a no-brainer to do something like that. Maybe give a character like a Castlevania whip to use, or you know, all these different types of weapons.
Or a lightsaber.
It seems like a no-brainer, but the developers are just not doing it. They're creating these alternate, you know, type of realities that in a lot of ways hurt PlayStation VR more than anything else. And hopefully they get it right. I think Resident Evil 7 Biohazard is going to be a huge step in the right direction. And I think it'll also show other developers what's really PSVR is capable of, because it doesn't seem like many other developers have really, really tapped into the true capabilities of what VR is all about. That's one of the biggest VR games of the year to me. It's a game I'm super amped for. I want to play it all the way through. And if I play it through, you know, play 2 or 3 hours a day without getting sick, I'm going to love it. I just can't wait to get my hands on it.
Yeah.
We had a really good question in chat, too, from MRobs, who was asking if we think that Microsoft would possibly get into the VR field, you know, with Xbox Scorpio and things like that.
I think they plan on absolutely it with the Scorpio.
They're going to, yeah.
It's already been confirmed that the Scorpio will be compatible with the Oculus Rift. I'm not sure about the HTC Vive.
Is that confirmed?
It's confirmed, yeah.
Oh, really?
But I'm not sure about the HTC Vive, but Oculus Rift will definitely work on the Xbox Scorpio.
I'm hearing great things about the Oculus and their touch controllers. Like, they are apparently phenomenal.
They're awesome.
Fortunately, it's very hard for me to give money to Oculus right now with the problems they're having internally with their staff.
Well, I mean, who knows what will happen? I'm really excited about 2017. Things I'm most excited about right now are the Nintendo Switch. 3 months away, guys. Here we are, 2017.
Holy shit, of course, the
Xbox Scorpio at the end of the year.
Press conference? They're going to do like a reveal.
The 11th or 12th of this
year. Yeah, it's 12th? 2 weeks about.
Nice.
It's close. So it's very close.
I mean, all the speculation will go out the window. We'll know exactly what, you know, GPU this thing has and what it's capable of.
I think we already do. It's the Tegra 1.
Is it the Tegra 1? I mean, I saw Digital Foundry's video on it. And they were talking about heavily speculated stuff that they feel is truly what we're going to get. But I feel like once we actually have this console out there and Nintendo actually verifies it 100%, well, no, yeah. Because for people who really wanted more out of this thing, the Tegra 1 doesn't seem like it's going to do, you know, really what it needs to do to compete with PS4 and Xbox One. There's always that hope that maybe they're able to get, it's going to be a unique GPU. It's not going to be the exact Tegra 1. It's from what I understand,
it's customized.
Tegra 1 chip. Hopefully they're able to get more out of it. We'll see exactly what type of internet capabilities this thing has, Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, speeds. So, I mean, I'm excited about the Wii U. I'm really, really amped for it. I may get two of them because when I go on the go.
You're getting two of them?
I mean, I'm sorry, Xbox. Shut up, Robbie.
I'm pre-ordering this thing. I'm pre-ordering the Switch. 2017. Without a doubt. Right? Because I want to make sure that if that console has a good launch, like if it has a good lineup at launch, if Zelda and Mario are there at launch, that's what I really want to say, then I want to be able to play those. If neither one of those are there, I don't have any interest in this console right now.
I feel the same way. The exact same way.
I think I agree with you guys too.
And I think just one of those is enough to pre-order. If they're both there, it's going to be a huge, you know, opening.
I prefer Zelda. That Zelda game looks incredible.
It looks great. But Briar, this is the thing. And I don't think we've really grasped it yet. We won't grasp it until March. We've never played on our PlayStation 4s, Xbox Ones, Xbox 360s, or PS3s, any game that we were heavily invested in, and then took it outside on the front porch and continued. It's never happened.
That's true.
So this is the Vita.
I have with the Vita, but it's a shitty experience.
It's not quite what we wanted, right?
No. Yeah. I have tried playing Destiny on Vita. It's fucking terrible.
I thought about trying that, but I was like, no.
This is going to be a huge game changer. I think the Nintendo Switch, as long as it's marketed correctly and people know that this is not, you know, the next Wii U, this is something totally different, more powerful, able to take it on the go and go anywhere. Doesn't need your Wi-Fi connection to stay connected. It's the actual game. Take it off, you know, go sit in the passenger seat of your car, get on the bus, get on the train, and continue to play. You get home, boom, put it in the docking station, and it's back on the big, beautiful screen. I think it's going to be incredible, man.
I mean, so far, right? They have nailed the marketing of this thing. Like, they're on a good track. And so this event they have coming up is going to be so important, I think, for them. Like, they got to knock it out.
The only marketing they've done is, like, the reveal trailer. The reveal trailer is really good. Then they showed it, was on Jimmy Kimmel?
Yeah.
Was it on Jimmy? I mean, that's good
too. One of those, yeah.
It's Jimmy. It's Fallon, I think. Jimmy Fallon. Too many damn Jimmys. But they showed it on his show, and I think that was another good mark. Reggie Fils-Aimé on there talking about it. And those are the only two things we've actually really seen. And I think that when it went on Fallon and people saw it actually work, come from the screen to the actual handheld portion and work flawlessly, that was the question that really mattered the most to a lot of people.
Now you know.
That the game that you're playing on your screen is going to transfer. It's going to be the same thing on this little tiny screen. And I'm super excited.
But it's going to have worse graphics.
Oh, it will. It's 40% less power.
Yeah. Supposedly.
On the portable version. But
which I don't really care about, to be honest with you.
As long as it works.
It's going to be on a smaller screen.
Same game? That's important to me. That's the big thing.
That Zelda game looks dope, though. It looks really good. I want the console for that game.
Yeah,
same.
It's gonna be a good year. I'm really looking forward to it. And this is the first episode of BC Thoughts 2017. I love you guys. Thank everybody for watching and hanging out with us. We didn't go through any news. We wanted to talk about a little last year. Talk about this.
We're making the news.
We are the news. Yeah,
bringing the news to you live.
Absolutely. We love you guys, and we're very thankful to everybody who's spending their time on their weekends, kicking it with us, talking about video games. Leave your comments below. Let us know how you feel about 2016, what you're looking forward to in 2017, what you got for Christmas last year. Were you excited? Were you disappointed? Did you get a sweater? If you did, send it back. But we love you guys. Thank you all so much for hanging out with us and kicking it for Beastly Thoughts. Oh, you got a sweater?
Yeah.
What kind of sweater?
Was it like a Christmas sweater?
It was a Christmas sweater, yes.
You didn't wear it, Robbie? What kind of shit? You should have worn it.
Oh.
Damn it. I want to see those shirts on Twitter, Robbie.
Yeah, Twitter. Twitter.
I got to get some new Christmas sweaters, though. I don't have really too many.
I don't have any either.
Guys, I got 4 weeks of vacation. What to do with this time? I've already talked to...
I know what you should do. play video games with me.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Caveat. I got a baby that's due in about 5 weeks.
Okay.
Kate looks like she's ready to drop her like now. I've never seen Kate make these faces. I mean, I'm sitting on the couch watching TV and I hear her wince in pain. And I look over, I'm ready to pick her up off the couch and run to the hospital. And then she looks at me and says, "I'm fine." I'm like, "No, the fuck you're not." So at any moment, this baby's going to pop. And so I'm going to take a few days to get to know my sweet little girl. But I'm planning the rest of the year out. We're going to kick it, have fun, play video games. And, of course, I'm off every weekend. So if you want to play video games with me, let me know in the comments below.
I want to play video games with you. I want to play video games with you, too, Robbie.
Yes, I want to play with you, too.
Look, let me know what you want to do first. We can do The Division or Werewolves Within. I think Werewolves Within will be huge on this Twitch channel.
I think it'd be fun, man. And I know, I want to get Gary in there too, because Gary, I really like playing with Gary too. So we gotta force him ready to go.
Okay, I'm ready.
Like a golf game, you gotta force him, and we're about to do it.
Oh, that sounds no VR for Robbie.
Never mind, we got a threesome.
No VR for me. That's what I'm saying. I'm like, I can't join.
You can watch. You can watch, Robbie. It's a threesome, Robbie, and you can watch. Okay.
Oh, it'll be like I'm just there. It'll be like I'm there. Yeah.
You can hold the camera, Robbie. You can hold the camera.
You just can't watch in VR. You got to watch on a old technology flat screen.
Yeah. With UHF and VHF, old school, Robbie.
UHF.
That he has no idea what those letters mean, Robbie and Brian. He doesn't know. So what? What?
Really? You don't know what that is?
What's UHF and VHF?
VHF and UHF? Maybe that wasn't a Canadian thing. Maybe that was an American broadcasting standard.
Probably. Yeah. It was some old school shit, Robbie. I remember those little knobs.
When your TV had a dial on it. And to change the remote control, they chose the smallest child in the house. And that was the remote control. You say, change it to channel 4, and that kid got up off the couch, walked to the TV, and turned the dial.
You have to adjust the antenna, too. I know that, yeah.
Yeah. If you're lucky, that shit was up on the roof. You get good reception. But if you had those little bunny ears, rabbit ears, God. All over the place.
I remember we thought we were getting fancy when our bunny ears had a little ring on the middle of them. I was like, ooh, what's that new little piece of technology?
Yeah.
Little aluminum hoop. To give you more signal. Oh my God.
Do you remember like people would have like aluminum foil on their rabbit ears?
Stuck on the ends,
yeah. What? That shit didn't help.
What?
You're
very lucky, Robbie.
Yeah.
You're very lucky.
You guys lived in. Jeez,
it was really crazy.
Dude, when I moved into this house, I'm still getting over the air.
Really?
Yeah, I don't like paying for cable, man. Cable pisses me off. It's too damn expensive.
Let me just say this, right?
Yeah. And you can get the same channels for free if you just plug in an antenna.
Yeah? My son told me this the day before yesterday. My son said, "Dad, I'm so happy you're my dad." He said, "My whole life growing up, I watched you never have cable." I said, "Why have cable if you got internet? You can watch all that shit on internet. Just go to YouTube. What's the point?"
Rum salt. It's free.
I got a smart TV, but look, I do have cable. I have basic cable in my home. The only reason that I do is because I was paid $100 a month for shitty internet, and they dropped it to $60 if I got the damn basic cable. I was like, how does this shit work?
Yeah.
You bring me a cable box, you install it, and I save $40. Bring it on.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Well, and you
that's why we have a home phone, Beasley. Yeah. Same thing.
Yeah,
it's literally cheaper to have the home phone service than to not have it.
Cheaper to keep her, bro. Cheaper to keep her, man. Yeah. It's cheaper to keep. Who has home phones anymore?
We do, actually.
You try to text the home phone.
We
you
have
think you
four
can text
cell phones and one home phone that nobody even answers if it rings. Not even, like, it's not even, nobody even, like, looks at the phone curiously. It just completely ignored it.
Nowadays, you're not excited to pick up the phone. No, it's like, when the phone rings.
And there's an answering machine message. There's an answering machine hooked up to it.
Don't even listen.
And nobody's checked those messages since I've lived here.
We have an answering machine.
This is why, right, Robbie? Just so you don't know. The reason that Brian doesn't check it, we have a home phone, but ours, when Kate was working for Apple, we had to have one installed. When you have cell phones, if someone calls your home phone, you know they ain't calling for you. That's somebody, telemarketer or some bullshit.
Yeah.
You know? And so if you
Dude, the NRA got a hold of my cell phone number. They have been calling me every day since, I think it's September. I thought it was going to stop. I thought it was an election thing. You know, I thought they just wanted to, hey, make sure you sign up for our guy who's going to make sure guns stay legal. I was sure of it, that that's why they were calling me every fucking day. But then in December, they kept calling. And now it's January, and they keep calling. Like, what the? Why is the NRA calling me? I can't be trusted with firearms. You can't give me firearms. That's not a good idea.
We get drill markers like every single day here too. I swear to God, it's so annoying. It's always the home phone. It's like, God.
You can't give me firearms.
Do I owe them money? I don't even know. Why would I owe the NRA money? That's the only reason I can think they'd be so persistent.
Oh, man. This is going to be such a great year when I get my new studio, guys.
Oh, yeah. Dude, I can't wait. You got to do an office setup. You got to do like a before and then an after too. Yeah.
Well, it'll just be an empty room before.
Right. Well, you got to show the empty room, you know?
These are the wood panes.
This is the empty space where I'm thinking about putting a TV.
This is the vent for the central
area. Are you going to go like a desk or are you going to go like an entertainment system and like a couch?
I think I'm going a desk and a couch because I already have. I got the couch here, right?
Best of both worlds.
This is a super comfortable couch, and my desk is in my son's room because in this apartment I don't have any room. It makes them look smart, but they never sit there, so you know. It's just there. But I got the desk. I'm going to have my laptop and everything in there, my computer set up. I'm going to have my camera set up, my lighting. Everything is going to be in this position. I'll never have to move a damn thing ever again. And my green screen is going to be there for my live stream. I'm going to get me a small, quaint little monitor so I can live stream from there. It's going to be awesome. I can't wait. I'm super amped.
My goal is to get the monitors off of my desk and mount like 50 to 60 inch TVs on the wall in front of me and then have a couch in front of the desk. Right. So like if I'm working, I'm looking at these big ass TVs or if I'm playing video games and live stream, I'm looking at these big ass TVs, but then I want to like relax and watch a movie in the office. I just move over there.
You leap over the desk and the monitors and then you leap onto the couch. Yeah.
I'll still like keep like, you that's know, a monitor because you don't want to like be working on like, you know, video editing or like Photoshop on a TV. You want to have a monitor, but you know, they're all mounted and you can swivel them around and shit.
I'm going to send you some pictures, Brian, of the new place. I might just upload a video and send to you privately, but that backyard is so big, man. I mean, it's so beautiful and large. It's going to take 2 hours to mow it.
Buying a house is one of the things that I was the most, like, still, the most exciting thing in my life is buying my first house. You know, it's just, like, as far as purchases go, like, nothing else compares. Mm-hmm. To finally live someplace that you feel ownership of.
It's like you've made it. Yeah.
It's not about making it. It's more of, like, this is finally, like, my home.
It's you. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like, now, when I go out and I mow the lawn, I'm mowing my lawn. Yard,
yeah. You know, I like that.
If I'm painting the house or I'm cleaning the windows or I'm weeding the front bed, like I feel ownership and a personal sense of satisfaction for doing it. Whereas when you rent all your life, you never really feel
you don't feel that freedom to do what you want with your place.
Yeah, so
you're maintaining for somebody else. Robbie, that mountain in your backyard is your mountain. Go mow the mountain.
Mow that mountain. We'll see you in 6 years.
Do you have any idea how many trees are on that mountain? That would take me like a year or two to chop all those down.
Chop them down. That's just irresponsible. Just trim them up a little bit. Make them look nice.
I'll send you some scissors, Robbie.
You ever see Karate Kid with the bonsai trees, you know?
It's going to take a lot longer, though.
You guys might think I'm kidding. Robbie has a fucking mountain in his backyard. And I'm not talking about a little hill. I mean a real mountain that you see in, like, you know, artistic pieces.
Yeah, it's dope.
You guys want to know something, too? In our old house, actually, our backyard was a mountain. It literally was. You climbed up it. It's like a hill.
What do you think the one you have behind your house is now?
Well, that's way further back. I'm saying we were like on a hill. Now the mountains are further back.
There's when you look at Robbie's backyard, there's a big ass mountain with a cloud in front of it.
It's a postcard. His backyard is a postcard.
I should send you some photos now. You have a snow.
And then you know what you should do is you should just take a bunch of pictures and then put welcome to Canada.
Sell
that shit. Because you live in a Canadian postcard.
Yeah, you
should. I literally do. Yeah, it's got every single season here. So
it's fucking awesome.
Is that it? Are we done?
What's with the silence?
2017 is going to be an interesting year. I can't wait.
There's a lot of games coming out.
Dive into it. Man, it's going to be a good year, guys. You guys,
like the first 3 months, man, there's so many good games coming out in January, February, and March. Like, it's going to be really exciting.
It's going to be even harder, you know. But my question for everybody out there, let us know the games you're most excited for this year.
Horizon Zero Dawn. Resident Evil. Right, oh, you so mean close. In the comments?
No, I need to hear from you too, Brian.
Horizon Zero Dawn is huge. Andromeda, Mass Effect Andromeda. Does that have a release date yet? Like a firm release date, or is it first
spring.
Quarter?
I think it's spring. I believe
they got pushed off to spring?
Yeah, unfortunately.
Resident Evil, like I really want to check it out. I'm a little scared of it.
Brian doesn't look like the pussy type, guys, but who?
Yeah, but I
you
am.
Never know. You never know.
I don't
just watch this stream.
I don't like horror movies, man. I do not like horror movies. And being in one,
playing.
Just let us know when the stream.
But then
is
we
happening.
Got the Switch coming out in March. Oh man, it's gonna be exciting. And then we got the Xbox One or Xbox Scorpio coming out.
Holiday.
Destiny 2, hopefully.
Yep.
News from Naughty Dog on The Last of Us 2 for
Naughty
2019.
Dog. Naughty Dog. I hopefully we'll see some more VR games come out. Like it's a good
some great ones, yeah.
Yeah.
Hopefully Robbie grabs his PSVR this year. We hate to leave you out of the conversations, so. Robbie.
Yeah.
You know, we'll see. There's a lot of people who already don't think you talk enough. And then when we talk about the topics of consoles and games that we have and you don't, it just feels like you're being excluded. Oh, get that fucking PSVR.
That's actually a good thing to mention. I'm not gonna lie to you guys, like some of the things I got for Christmas, you know, of course I got the Astros, I got some games, I got clothes, all that stuff's great. I got a shit ton of cash. Like I got like $500 from relatives. I'm not even kidding. So,
well,
maybe I'll
sure.
buy PSVR. I don't know. We'll see.
You better go get that shit, Robbie. It's a good investment, man.
I'm doing pretty well financially though for my age. I'll say that.
Well, I can't say that.
That's you know, the worst financial advice really I've ever heard.
That's
you
really.
Gotta,
that's,
you gotta go get a PSVR. It's a good investment.
Go buy it. That's what I'm saying. $500 to buy the VR. That's all you need.
It sounded good coming out, but then when it bounced off the walls in here, it hit me back. Right. I was like, hey, what the fuck did I just say?
Don't ever listen to a 20-year-old for financial advice, okay? It's not
don't, you know what? Get somebody else to buy you PlayStation VR, Robbie.
Yeah, that's the way to do it right there.
I know. I got a lot of other things I want to save up for. So
all I want for birthday is a PlayStation VR and a Porsche. Not one of those shitty boxers either. I want a 911, you motherfuckers.
I'm spoiled, though. But yeah, I'm spoiled.
Oh, my God. That's a hell of a
gift. Four-wheel drive joints. Yeah. All right. I think that's going to wrap it up. What do you think?
Happy New Year, guys.
Happy New Year.
Thanks for hanging out with the Beastly Thoughts crew today. Live on Twitch and on YouTube if you guys are watching us on YouTube.
That's right. Thank you guys for hanging out. We will see you next week.
Have an awesome day, you guys.